Chapter 1 Queen Victoria's long reign and the 19th century were both drawing to a close when a sad little procession straggled its way back from the cemetery to a cobbled alley near the docks. Supported by their closest neighbours, the Dawson children had just seen the remains of their beloved parents lowered into a pauper's grave and covered with a very thin layer of earth and slaked lime. Deep and foul-smelling, the grave would be kept open until no more of the bare wooden coffins supplied by the parish could be fitted inside. The disgrace of not being able to pay for a more dignified funeral had made the grief of the older boys 10 times worse. 11-year-old David Dawson, trudging along in his broken, ill-fitting shoes, had a toddler with a very runny nose hanging round his neck. Robert, a year younger and barefoot, was carrying their baby sister. Pale-faced and as thin as broomsticks, they were all poorly dressed to face the biting wind blowing off the great river. They'd never known anything different. Not for them, a share of the exotic foods brought up the Thames into London by the great merchant ships and unloaded by their father and thousands like him. Cold and hunger went side by side for the families of the labourers who gathered at the dock gates in all weathers, hoping for a day's work. Their pay was such that it often only ran to bread with a thin scraping of margarine or a few potatoes, all washed down with sugary tea. Most families were large, and sometimes there wasn't even enough of that meagre fare to go round. "I'd take you all in if I could, you poor little lambs," said Mrs. Thompson, wiping her eyes on the neatly mended cuff of her best blouse. "But you know how it is." David nodded. The kindly woman with 7 hungry mouths to feed already and another baby due any day had got her black shawl out of pawn to wear as a sign of respect. He knew that she could ill afford it, but his mother would have done the same. Good neighbours always did their best for each other in times of trouble. "We'll manage," said David, his voice a little shaky. "I can work, and Robert can stay off school to look after Albert and Minnie." Mrs. Thompson looked doubtful. "What will you do, David? You're too young to be taken on at the docks." "I can do lots of things. We'll be fine, you'll see." It was not to be. David asked everywhere for errands to run, windows to wash, and paths to sweep. He scoured the streets for wood to chop up and sell as kindling. He held horses' heads while their drivers took a break, and he chased off the strays pestering the cat's meat man. Worn out by the end of the first week, he hadn't even made enough to pay the rent on their cramped and comfortless flat, and the landlord ordered them to leave. Then someone, maybe even the landlord himself, notified the authorities. Screeching gulls circled overhead as David turned round to take his last glimpse of the towering warehouses along the docks. All he could think of was that he'd let the younger children down. Had they been spared the typhoid fever that carried off their parents, only to end up in the dreaded workhouse? The very idea of it loomed like an evil shadow over the lives of everyone he knew, and he began to tremble with fear. "Once inside its high walls," they said, "you might as well be dead."